I'm at the home of cricket to meet one of England's very best. From humble beginnings in Sheffield, to World Cup wins through Ashes victories, to captaining his country and beyond, here is the story of cap number 655.
It reminds me of some great moments on the field.
Eased through the offside.
I'm very grateful and honoured to get the opportunity to captain your country. To make 100 here at the home of cricket, for it to be an Ashes game as well, made it a real sweet one.
Second 100 for England.
Towards the back end of my captaincy, I didn't realise how much of a toll it was really taking. It reminds me of family and friends that have taken me here, there and everywhere up and down the country and created opportunities for me.
One of England's all-time greats.
Going all the way back, was it always cricket for you?
Yeah, from being really small, as long as I can remember really, I had a bat in my hand and me and my brother would play test matches in the garden on the driveway. We'd go to watch Dad play on a weekend club cricket. The family would take me to play tennis, hockey, obviously cricket, football, whatever it was. So I got exposed to a lot of opportunities at a very young age, and cricket was the one that sort of I enjoyed the most and loved.
So growing up then, the cricket that you would have played, perhaps not so much school cricket for you, but the club environment was the place where you really got stuck into playing the game on a slightly more serious level.
From being 7, 8 years old, I'd be playing under 11s cricket for Rotherham Town, and then for Sheffield Collegiate under 13s, 15s, 17s. I think exposure to the amount of cricket that I got, and you know, even playing men's cricket at such a young age, certainly helped me learn to play the game, understand what it's about, but I think gave me a big step forward and I suppose boosting, you know, getting to where I am today.
The spectre of Yorkshire County Cricket Club probably loomed quite large. You know, Sheffield Collegiate had already produced guys like Michael Vaughan. So you were already in an environment whereby it felt tangible. It felt like you could reach out and touch the idea of becoming a professional cricket player. So what was that like? How did it drive you? And when did they first sort of come knocking on your door?
Yeah, I mean, seeing guys like that, mentioned Michael Vaughan, there was Richard Kettleborough as well, went on and played for Yorkshire and Middlesex. Seeing those guys go and do it and play for Yorkshire, play even for England in Michael's case, it made it that little bit more believable and an attainable goal. I got the opportunity to trial for the Yorkshire under-11s and managed to sneak my way in there. And very lucky at 12, Kevin Sharp, who was the batting coach at the time, gave me the opportunity to be part of a scholarship scheme at the club and had the exposure to work with him on a regular basis, be around the first team a little bit, watch guys like Anthony McGrath, Matthew Wood, you know, Jacques Rudolph, these really prestigious first-class players and international players go about their business firsthand, and I think are very fortunate to get exposed to that so early. It also drove me on more. Very grateful to Kev, he put a lot of hard work into my game as a young lad, coming through that system, and I owe a lot to him for the work he did.
So your first outings as a Yorkshire first team player, was it at Pro 40 game you would have played?
I think I lost us that game, yeah.
Did
I
you?
Like 60 of 100 balls, I think. And yeah, it was a sort of dead rubber for us, and I managed to get the opportunity to play. And I opened the bat and wasted the power play, blocking it around, and then got to 60 odd. I thought I'd done really well, and they knocked it off with about 10 overs to go. So, but it was a great experience, obviously. Big deal for me at the time. And it was nice to get some runs and feel like you know, I had the game to, albeit probably a little bit too slowly, I had the game to cope at that level. And you know, I think I had to wait a year until I played championship cricket.
Yeah.
And I got 16 ball naught first innings, which is a nice sort of realisation of the hard work that you...
There's a level there, isn't there? There's another step up, and you kind of think, you think you've made it because you've managed to get your cap, and then it's like, oh, hang on a second.
Yeah.
These guys are probably a little bit better than I gave it credit for.
Graham Thorpe had seen me play in the second team when he was involved at Surrey, and then was involved in the Lions setup as a batting coach, and I got the opportunity to be a part of that Lions squad at the back end of that year. So, again, exposure to a brilliant coach, someone that put a huge amount of time and energy into my game, but teaching me about different conditions, learning to play spin, learning to play fast bowling, learning to play the short ball. Sometimes things that you don't always experience in county cricket. So it was great for him to pass on that knowledge and wisdom and experience that to me at, 20 years old, ahead of going on and playing for England.
I'll let you into a little secret. Graham Thorpe called me probably around 2010, 11, and said, I've seen the future of English batting, and his name is Joe Root. He was talking about you.
But he was brilliant, honestly. We had some great discussions, whether it be over a beer or working hard in the nets, whether it be in India, Sri Lanka, Australia. He'd obviously done it all, played 100 test matches, lived and breathed the highs and lows of international cricket, and really did a brilliant job in readying me for everything that was to come.
Find yourself on an England tour.
I just thought I've got an opportunity here to better my game.
Were you chasing those other guys, or were you very much looking after your own business?
I watch a lot of them play. Everything around an Ashes test match and a series, it goes up another level.
So we've gone through all the trials and tribulations of becoming a professional cricketer and kind of learning what it's about to earn your living doing something that you love. And then eventually you've impressed everybody to the point where you find yourself on an England tour.
Yeah.
In India, of all places. What was it like going into that environment? These are people, presumably, that you'd have watched play on TV and they'd have been heroes of yours, and suddenly you're in there with them.
I'd been playing test matches in the garden as these guys for years. And then you walk into a dressing room with Kevin Peterson, Jonathan Trott, Alistair Cook, Matt Prior, a side that had recently got to number one in the world and sort of won away in Australia for the first time in a long time. And you've got the exposure of all this knowledge and skill. I was probably a bit of a pest to them all, really, trying to get as much out of them as I could. But they were all brilliant, welcomed me into the dressing room. Guys like Cookie, I watched play and watch how disciplined he was about how he wanted to go about things. And it was very much that way in his practice and set the example. Then you'd watch and train. I'd train hard with Kev, actually, talking about how to play spin. And he was very good with me as a young lad coming into the team.
Mm. He doesn't have that reputation, but a lot of people
he was very good.
That I've spoken to since have said, no, if you wanted anything about batting, Kevin Peterson was your man.
We did a lot of work together, learning how to play spin and what worked for me, trying to hit the ball through the offside, opening up the whole ground for as long as possible. Mm. And figured out throughout that trip a method of how I wanted to go and play spin and how I was going to score runs. Finally got the opportunity at the back end of that tour and managed to crab it around enough to...
Two 50s on debut, made sure that England drew that last match in Nagpur and historically won the series in India 2-1. So, you're being very modest, but it was a fine effort. Something you said there, you said you would have driven them mad asking them lots of questions. Are you still like that now? Are you naturally inquisitive? Is that something that naturally comes to you, or you just felt, I can't miss out on this opportunity?
Yeah, I just felt like it was a great chance to learn from some of the best players England's ever produced. Yeah. You're looking at Kev, who was one of the most exciting players to watch play and could turn a game on his own, and Cookie, leading run scorer of all time. There's Ian Bell, one of the nicest batters on the eye to watch. I just thought, I've got an opportunity here to better my game and try and develop and evolve as a player.
Such was your impact in that final match on the India tour. You were first name on the team sheet in the very next summer. There were some goals to be ticked off, and you managed one of those very early on against New Zealand.
Felt like I was getting close to making a real big contribution in the team. I'd put a good couple of scores together here in the first test match. Four. And then got to Headingley home ground. I felt in good order. I'd scored some runs in the county system ahead of the test matches and managed to get in and go on and make 100, and it was quite special, obviously being a weekend at your home ground, place where you've played a lot of cricket, learned to play the game, to be able to enjoy that atmosphere within in there was really quite special.
He's done it! The moment that Joe Root will never forget. And he becomes the first Yorkshire player ever to get his first international 100 here at Headingley. A star is born.
It probably got me out, actually. I was still thinking about it and sort of riding the high of getting to that 100. I wasn't switched back on and played a terrible shot to get out. It was a tremendous, something that I'll never forget. It was really quite special. Yeah.
Had the crowd cottoned on to the long route yet, or was that something that came later?
I wasn't quite sure what was going on to start with. I thought I was getting
booed to
start with. I thought, I need to change the way I play it. They're not entertained. They're not liking what they're seeing. But finally, sort of cottoned on to what it was. So always nice to hear.
So when you realised that you were going to be playing for England in an Ashes series, how did that feel?
Amazing. It was unbelievable. Obviously, to play international cricket is extremely special. But this, the build up, the everything around an Ashes Test match in a series it goes up another level and something that I'd not experienced before. And, got the opportunity to open the batting in that series. So I remember walking out at the start of it all, there was the Red Arrows were flying over us, we just sang the national anthem, goosebumps there, I've got Cookie next to me. And you know, you're out there, and I remember sort of hairs on my arms standing up and right, here we go. And it was an incredible experience. The first test match was really tight game, really good one to be involved in, and then we came here and we dominated that test match from start to finish. It was nice to, I think I got dropped early on and then managed to go on and make a decent score. So again, to make 100 here at the home of cricket with all the history and everything that comes with playing at this great ground,
yeah,
was for it to be an Ashes game as well, made it a real sweet one.
Oh, what a ball to give him. Exactly the opposite of what Mark said. That was a shocking delivery, but what a lovely feeling when Joe Root hits it. Second 100 for England, but the first as an opener and the first at Lord's.
Are you somebody that sort of has found it relatively straightforward to keep your feet on the ground, or have you kind of had those, you know, those moments where you're king of the world, and then, you know, when things don't go quite so well, you end up with the real lows that come on the opposite side of that?
I've generally been relatively quite good at staying level. There was obviously that winter I ended up getting left out of the side after a couple of low scores and poor performances, and it did knock me back a little bit. Lost a bit of confidence from that, but it gave me a better understanding of myself and my game and how I wanted to go about it from that point onwards. So I went away, and instead of trying to spend all of my energy and time working on things that I needed to improve on, I made sure that my strengths were as good as they possibly could be, and then slowly but surely edged away at the other areas of my game that needed improvement. And
the idea that you would find yourself being spoken about relatively quickly after making your debut in the sort of like the top echelon of world batting, you know, you were in the and still are probably top of it now, the Fab Four as it was at the time. Again, was that something that you were aware of, something that you kind of were very proud to be spoken of? Did it kind of drive you still further? Were you chasing those other guys, or were you very much looking after your own business?
Very much looking after my own house, to be honest. I think the one thing I would say, you mentioned those three players, Virat Kohli, Kane Williamson, Steve Smith. I watch a lot of them play. Right. I love watching them play. I think they're all wonderful run makers. You look at all very different styles and different ways of doing it. Someone like Virat's got a very all-round game, which is fabulous to watch. And then someone like Steve Smith, you watch him play. The way he figures out bowling attacks, where he figured out his own game and has got a very good understanding of how he's going to score his runs. It's very unique, but it's very effective, and he's very clever about how he goes about it, I think. Creates good angles, makes it difficult for bowlers to bowl at him. And then someone like Kane, who's just a brilliant technician. You look at his game, it's as good as it can be. He plays the ball so late. He's very in control of what he does. He looks like he has so much time. So I watch those guys play, and I try and just take as much from it, add to my game where it fits in as I can.
How much work do you do on the mental side of batting, just in terms of getting your mind into a space where you're ready to go out there and perform?
I think it's the most challenging part of Test cricket. It's the amount of time you have to think about dismissals, whether you get it wrong. about if someone's got you out a few times, have they got the wood over you sort of thing. And it's so easy to sort of get dragged into that. I think that's probably the most challenging part of international cricket. But it's not always been straightforward, I'll be honest. There have been times where I feel like I've got it wrong, but learn from those experiences and feel a better player for going through that. And I don't think it's a bad thing to find it hard sometimes. It's just how you process that those difficult moments and how you get through it is the really important thing, how quickly you can get the other side of it. And like I said earlier, I've had some great people to work with, to speak to about how to manage those passages of play and moments in my career to get me back to where I needed to be, which is in a good space to go and score runs. I think sides work you out, they figure out how they want to get you out and they exploit weaknesses, so you've constantly got to keep finding ways to evolve as a player technically, but also mentally be smart, try and stay ahead of the game, stay ahead of the trend.
What about the other sides, the off-field parts of captaincy?
As captain, it definitely took a massive toll on me.
What are the memories?
It's hard to look past Headingley. It was incredible to be a part of. And there are moments that, as a side, you really cherish.
Not only have you established yourself as one of the best batters in the world, there comes a crossroads in most England teams whereby a great player, a great captain has decided that it's time to step away and a successor needs to be found. Alistair Cook has decided it's time for him to step down. That means it's going to be you.
Yeah.
Or does it?
I remember getting the call. It was quite a special week that he stepped down. He had to wait till June or something for the test matches to start, for it all to kick in. And I'm very grateful and honoured to get the opportunity to captain your country. It's a big deal. And I knew it was going to be a lot of hard work and it was going to change my place in the team, the way I was going to have to operate was going to have to change. And I was really excited about that challenge and that opportunity. Yeah.
Would you say that you were a born leader? Was it something that you felt incredibly comfortable with, or is it something that you had to find your way around as you got into the job?
No, I'd say that I had to work hard at it. I don't think it was natural for me. I'm not like a big imposing guy. I don't walk in and hold the room naturally like some other guys do. Mm. So I think I had to find other ways to try and inspire the boys. And I think over time you sort of figure out what works for you, what doesn't work for you.
The team was in a little bit of flux, wasn't it? You had some greats of the game winding down their careers or finding themselves on the wrong side of selection. You were bringing new guys in. How did that dynamic change within the dressing room from the time when you were in the ranks?
I think there's always that sort of natural evolution of teams, and it was an opportunity when I came in to, I suppose, just change a few things, how we wanted to play and stuff. And I wanted us to be quite aggressive to start with. Mm. That was initially how we set out to do things. And you look at the players that we had, guys like Ben, Moeen Ali. He obviously had a bit of stability at the top of the order with great Sir Alistair Cook. Mm-hmm. And then you got the two goats of fast bowling in Jimmy and Broadie. So I had a lot of experience to rely on there. And within that, it felt like there was opportunities for guys to come in and sort of try and mould a team around that sort of core nucleus.
What about the other sides, the off-field parts of captaincy? I always hear, and I know, having captained a counties team for over a number of years, that it's not necessarily the stuff that happens on the field and around the dressing room. You're comfortable with that. Mm-hmm. That's the world you know. It's the things that you have to do outside of that start to, they don't take their toll, but they chip away a little bit because you feel as though you're having less and less time for yourself and to work on your own game.
You're right, it does takes a lot of energy away from you over a period of time, and I found that towards the back end of my captaincy for sure, with COVID and I suppose the external stuff that we had to go through and procedures with bubbles, and there was so much more to worry about than just performing out on the field. I personally believe it got to a stage where we weren't preparing to play test matches. You could see the guys felt like they were just being rolled out to play rather than to roll out to go and win a game. As captain, it definitely took a massive toll on me, and I think you could see it in the performances that we put in. I didn't realise how much of a toll it was really taking until I got home from the West Indies. And as soon as I made the decision to step away, it felt like I'd lifted the weight of the world off my shoulders. You know, I felt present again. I felt back to myself, and I felt very honoured and grateful to get the opportunity to lead England for such a long period of time. But it was not just for me personally, but for the team as well. It was the right time to step away for us to go in a new direction.
But your personal level of performance over the course of the COVID period of time, and the bubbles and everything, was utterly unbelievable.
Yes.
And as is so often, Root is away straight away with a sumptuous cut up the slope for four.
Whilst it's having this mental effect on you, you are still able to go out there and play. Is that experience? Is that what getting a little bit older and having done it for so long does? You can compartmentalise one thing and get on with the other.
One thing I gained a lot of clarity throughout the first half of COVID, if you like, I went away, I worked on my game, I looked at areas and modes of dismissal, different points of my innings, and tried to minimise sort of how I was getting out. You mentioned being in those environments for long periods of time. For me personally, going out to bat was the quiet time. That was the peace and quiet. That's gotcha. Where I could relax. That's where I could just go and play and enjoy cricket and not have to worry about anything and just sort of try and put in that big score, that contribution, which set a game for us to go and hopefully win.
You did it for 5 years. You won more test matches than any other captain. What are the memories or the series or the things that stand out for you as being kind of, you know what, that was special, that was fantastic?
It's hard to look past Headingley. That Ashes test match was incredible to be a part of. We felt like we bowled really well first innings, bowled them out for 180. Turned up the next day, sun was out, pitch looked nice and white. Thought, great opportunity to pile the runs on and drive the game forward from there. Before lunch, we're fielding again. so it didn't quite go like that, but the way that we bounced back after that, I thought, was incredible. To see Ben go and everyone forgets the shift he put in with the ball. It was an incredible spell of bowling. Me and him walked off the field. I think one of the Aussie lads, had a little word with him. And he just looked me in the eye and said, I cannot wait to shake his hand at the end of the game when we've won. And he did it.
Yes! For Headingley, 1981. Reid Headingley, 2019. One of, if not the greatest, test match innings ever played.
It was remarkable, honestly, seeing the emotions and the roller coaster of the guys in the dressing room. I remember looking Leachie in the eye and saying, well, ever there's two of you there, there's still an opportunity to win this game. And getting the blankest look back off him in a like, nod before he walked out to bat.
To make the most famous one not out ever.
Exactly, yeah. Sharing those moments, like, thinking about all of the great things that went on that week. They're the bits that you remember, I suppose. Some brilliant away tour wins in South Africa and Sri Lanka. And they're moments that, as a side, you'd really cherish.
Keen to leave it there for the moment, but I think we should go and find somewhere to have a sit so you can talk us through some of your favourite and best moments over the course of your career.
Cool.
What do you reckon?
Let's go.
Okay. Tell us a bit about your favourite moments.
What comes with that first test and just a sense of belonging and feeling that you're actually good enough to survive and play test cricket. The journey that we went on as a team from scoring all those big scores which changed the way people looked at playing 50 over cricket. The atmosphere within the ground was something that I'll always remember. I get goosebumps even now just thinking about it.
A bit more comfortable. Tell us a bit about your favourite moments or perhaps the innings that stand out in your mind, the real special ones to you?
The ones that probably stand out would be, it's hard to look past the first one. I think what comes with that first test and just a sense of belonging and feeling that you're actually good enough to survive and play test cricket, what it gives you as a player is more than just the runs that you produce. So I think that was a very special one for a number of reasons. The fact that it was at Headingley, home crowd, was really quite cool. I think as a young English lad, one team that you want to have success against and to contribute in wins against is Australia. And to get an Ashes 100 here was very special. And then to go on and win that series was really quite cool, and nice to look back on it, knowing that you played a part in it. I guess the more and more you play, it's not necessarily the hundreds that you remember, it's the moments that you create, the partnerships that you've been involved in. Like this summer's been so enjoyable watching Johnny go about his business at the other end, and actually the way he played made my life a lot easier, putting pressure on the bowlers all the time, made it very difficult for some world-class bowlers to execute what they were trying to do because of how he was playing.
The run chase in particular, yeah, against India at Edgbaston.
Exactly that, and obviously how destructive he was at Trent Bridge. I think that will always be very special, because coming back into the team, no longer captain, I was quite nervous about that for a number of reasons. Now Ben, as a player, and when I was in charge, he was the person that I'd always turn to if needed something to happen. Needed to make a play in the game, he'd be the one guy that would stand up and do it for me. And so many times I could count on him, I wanted to sort of repay the favour, and that's obviously my goal moving forward, is to try and be that go-to guy for him when it comes to our batting. So it was nice to get 100 in the, to chase that score down, to start, I suppose, this new era of this team off in a winning way. And quite cool as well that it turned out to be my 10,000th run as well. So yeah, that was pretty special. Nice that the family was there as well watching on. So.
Down the pitch, he clips it to the deep. Can he come back for two? He can. A 26th Test 100 for Joe Root. 10,000 Test runs for Joe Root. He joins the pantheon of all-time great batters. One of England's all-time greats.
Going back to talking about your first 100, I mean, you've made 28 of them now. Are you somebody that gets nervous in the 90s at all? Did you then? Do you remember?
I remember that first 100 actually was against New Zealand, and Brendan was actually captain at the time. I remember him reviewing a shout for caught down the leg side because I looked a little bit guilty. Thankfully, it just flicked my pad and I didn't nick it, but I remember being quite nervous on that occasion. Managed to nick one through third slip for four. Pretended like I'd meant to do it, and charged off celebrating.
Talk to us about the World Cup. Leading run scorer for England, being right at the very heart of it from the start. Something that also must have been a boyhood dream of yours. To get that over the line must have been incredible.
It was. It's a really enjoyable journey, the whole 4 or 5 years leading into that. The journey that we went on as a team, from scoring all those big scores, which we almost changed the way people looked at playing 50 over cricket. And then for us to get into a position where we've got a home World Cup, we're playing some really good cricket. It wasn't straightforward, but when it really mattered, the lads stood up and produced some brilliant moments. And I mean, what a final to be a part of. The emotion and the atmosphere within the ground was something that I'll always remember. I get goosebumps even now just thinking about it. It's really cool.
It seems as though, perhaps, at this point in your career, that you've kind of done everything that there is to do. Right? Yeah. But I'm guessing from that little grin and that little smirk that all those years on, what was it, 2012, 10 years later, international cricketer of great renown, that there's plenty left, that there's more driving you on to get better and to have more moments like the World Cup and Ashes wins.
You have to evolve as a player, you have to evolve as a leader or a senior player as well. And I've really enjoyed this summer working with some of the younger guys, the batters, now not being captain, having good conversations and talking through how we play different situations, building those friendships and partnerships around the games, but in the games as well. And then seeing, you get a great reward seeing those guys go out and deliver.
What's next on the horizon for you, or is it simply being a good part of the team and contributing to Test match wins?
Yeah, I think just that really. I'm not someone that will chase milestones. Obviously, your job is to go and score runs and score as many as you can, and just make sure you're doing it in the best way to set up as winning a game or to chase the score down. And you know, if you're doing all those things right, then they'll look after themselves. The scores will come. And
well, it's been fascinating looking back at your career and having you talk about it so eloquently. You've got 125th cap coming up. Touch wood. But for now, we've managed to get our hands on this cap number 655, the first one you were ever presented. Yeah. Do you remember who gave it to you what was said?
Yeah, Paul Collingwood gave me this cap. He told me the story of how his is still in his sock drawer, so every morning he wakes up and he sees it and he relives all of the memories that he created as a player. It was really special that, you know, someone that I admired so much passed this on to me. He just said, go and create some memories. And thankfully, I can look back, and every time I look at this badge or this weathered old cap, it reminds me of some great moments on the field, some great moments in the dressing room, and some great friendships that have been built throughout that period of time. It reminds me of family and friends that have taken me here, there and everywhere up and down the country and created opportunities for me. And you know, all the players that played before and inspired me as well to get to here. So it means a huge amount to me for a number of different reasons, and one of my very treasured and prized possessions.
Well, you can't say that you haven't deserved all of those memories, Joe. You've been a magnificent servant to that cap, that crest, and to this country and the cricket that has been played by it. Wonderful talking to you. Thank you for being so candid, and may there be many more memories in that cap.
Thank you very much. Cheers, Butch.